I want to acknowledge and pay respects to the Kaurna people, the original custodians of the Adelaide Plains, and the land on which all three of the university campuses are built. These lands have never been ceded. We acknowledge the deep feelings of attachment and the relationship of the Kaurna people to country, and we respect and value their past, present, and ongoing connections to the land, the sea, and their cultural beliefs. And I invite everyone else to share their acknowledgements of the country that they might be on in the chat, as usual. It's my great pleasure this morning to kick off our 2023 seminar series with Katherine Strandburg. As everyone in this group, because they're members of the team, know, Katherine is huge in the field of commons, particularly looking at governance and legal aspects of the commons. And this morning, she's going to talk to us about privacy, which is something we've already been talking about in the group. Katherine is a professor of law at NYU and currently on leave in Chicago, hence the conversation a second ago. And we're really, really grateful she was willing to give up a bit of her sabbatical to talk to us today about privacy. So Katherine says she's got more than she'll be able to get through. Katherine, are you happy to take questions as we go? Or would you prefer?
Absolutely. Yeah.
It's a small group, so it should be easy. Yeah. I'll try and control traffic. So if you can just throw up your hand if you want to ask a question. And we'll leave some time at the end as well. Over to Katherine.
Okay. Well, let me share my screen. I have some slides. So I'm going to focus mainly on our work on looking at privacy as knowledge commons governance, and I'll talk about what we mean by that. Also, I think you're going to be hearing from my colleague Michael Madison in a couple of weeks. So I think what I will be telling you will provide also some background for what he's going to talk about. So I'll hopefully save him a little time in his presentation. I just want to acknowledge that this is work that has been done most especially with Madeline Sanfilippo, who is now at University of Illinois in the Information School, and also with my longtime colleagues, Brett Frischman and Mike Madison. And then also we've had a lot of other people who've contributed case studies to both the privacy work and all of our knowledge commons governance work. So the work that on privacy, particularly as knowledge commons, is reflected in both a book and an article. And also there is more information about all of our work at the website knowledge-commons.net. I should also mention the book and actually all the books in our series are available open access. So if you want to follow up by looking at any of the case studies, I'm not going to really talk specifically about many of the case studies, maybe about none of them. I might talk about one if there's time. You might be interested, and feel free to just take a look because it's open access. Okay, so what I want to try to do today, and again, feel free to just interrupt with questions and, you know, at any point, whatever you'd like to do. The basic outline of what I'm going to do is I'm first going to talk about what I'm going to use as my theoretical basis for talking about privacy, which is Helen Nissenbaum's contextual integrity theory. So I'll talk a little bit about that. Then I'll talk about the governing knowledge commons framework that I developed with Brett and Mike, and now Madeline. And then move on to talking about how contextual integrity and the GKC framework really go very well together. And then I'll tell you a little bit about some of the observations, sort of overall observations that came out of the privacy as commons case studies that are described in our book, and some of which I was involved with, some of which I was not at all involved with, but some overall observations. And then if there's time, I will tell you a little bit about a study of using the framework, a study of the one of the Rare Disease Research Network Consortia that are funded by the NIH here in the US that I conducted with collaborators, actually it's a few years ago now, but just a kind of as an example, only if there's time. Okay, so that's the plan. So contextual integrity. Whenever you start to talk about privacy, there could be many things, and there are many different ways of thinking about what privacy means and why it's protected and so forth. I personally like to think about privacy in terms of the theory that Helen Nissenbaum put forth in her book, Privacy in Context, and lots of other work of hers, called Contextual Integrity. The idea, basic idea, Helen's a philosopher, she used to be at NYU, and we used to work very closely at the Information Law Institute. In fact, she started it. Her basic approach is to argue that we should think about privacy not specifically necessarily as control, definitely not as secrecy, but as appropriate personal information flow, and I would add use, given the context. And this is kind of important in terms of a framing of how to think about privacy, because it gets away from the idea that privacy is necessarily all about consent, which it may not be, at least not under this theory. And also about the idea that privacy necessarily means not having information flow. And so, you know, as a lawyer, and you guys are in the medical area, we all know that one of the reasons for having privacy is to encourage the flow of information. So clients will speak to their lawyers because they know the lawyers will keep the information confidential. Patients will speak to doctors because they know that the doctors will keep the information confidential. And so in general, if we think about privacy as being about stopping information flow, I would argue, following on Helen, that that's just the wrong way to be thinking about it. What we should think about privacy as being a ways of governance, and I'll get to that in a minute, that allows information to flow in ways that are appropriate for the context. Now here, context, when Helen uses the term context, she means sort of broadly and without defining it too narrowly, a social context. So healthcare might be a context, medical research might be a context, education a context, and so forth. Personal information in this approach is also very broadly defined and can be very broadly defined because the question is the flow of personal information appropriate? Where it is appropriate, then we're happy to see it flow. So that's kind of the background view of privacy. Now, Helen also has in her approach to privacy, I think, a really useful analytical framework that also turns out to map very well onto the commons framework that we use. And I'll talk about that mapping in a minute. But the analytical framework is that if we want to think about a flow of personal information, we have to think about this flow in terms of who's the sender of the information, who is the subject of the information, what kind of information is it, what is its content, who's receiving the information, and very importantly, what is the transmission principle that describes the conditions for this information to flow. Putting these all together, you get what Helen calls a norm. There are so many different definitions of norm, but this is her definition. And these kinds of norms can be regulated in many different ways. It could be informal, what we would kind of more informally call social norms. It could be a law. It could be a contractual agreement among people. And the kinds of things that we might talk about when we're talking about transmission principles might be something like only with consent, or might be something like whenever you want, or might be, I mean, there could be many different transmission principles. And if you analyze an information flow in this way, in this very specific way, then you are set up to ask the question about whether this particular flow, this information from this sender to this recipient about this subject is appropriate with this transmission principle. And so here are just a couple of like toy examples that I use with my class to explain this that I thought might be useful. So suppose we imagine information that content is that a child has either dyslexia or ADHD, or information that a child is a talented pianist, right? So suppose the parent is the sender and the recipient, the teacher is the recipient. What might be the kinds of transmission principles under which this information would flow? So if we're talking about something like the child has dyslexia or ADHD or some other sort of learning disability, then probably we're going to have a transmission principle, and probably it would be appropriate to have a transmission principle that would say, this is transmitted under conditions of confidentiality, but it's okay for the teacher to tell the special ed teacher, the classroom aide. There are certain people who would be, it would be all right. If the information is that the child is a talented pianist, well, then maybe that might have different transmission principles, or maybe not. Maybe we want to say the child's consent is required, or maybe not. We would have principles about whether it's okay for the teacher to disclose things further. And similar, there's like a lot of other similar examples here. But you can see how if you map this things out in this way, you get a much more fine-grained view of what is the information flow and whether it's appropriate. Then if you just focus on the sensitivity of the information or whether there was consent and so forth. And in particular, sometimes it's okay to, we consider it okay for information to be disclosed without an individual's consent. So I didn't put this example is not on this on the slide, but one example of that is to law enforcement if they have a warrant, right? So this is a transmission principle that makes it an information flow that would otherwise be inappropriate become appropriate. So those are just kind of examples of what I'm talking about when I'm talking about this contextual integrity approach to privacy. Okay, so if we buy that, if you're with me on that so far, then of course we have this question of appropriate. So what is appropriate? So Nissenbaum, especially in like in her book and in her earlier work, she has the following ideas about what makes what we can use to decide whether an information flow is appropriate. We look at the context. So the context is very important for informing us in whether particular information flow is appropriate. For example, you know, if the same person is playing the role of physician who's consulting on a case or social acquaintance, then the question of whether the information flow is appropriate would be very, very different. So what do these contexts give us? They give us, first of all, they give us sort of entrenched norms that have already been kind of created and are already there. They also give us background norms and values that will sometimes justify some kinds of personal information flows and uses. They also, besides this, we also have, besides these very contextual values and norms, we also have, of course, general moral principles that should help to resolve remaining questions. In kinds of situations where, for example, there are no contextual norms that apply to a particular information flow because this information flow involves a new social or technological situation that we just didn't have before, so no norms have developed. Or when two different contexts overlap and there are competing values, then according to Helen's perspective, we use general moral principles to resolve these remaining questions. So a question that came to my mind in thinking about this and all with Brett and Madeline, we thought about this is, okay, this is fine if you're a philosopher, but what about in the practical world, right? So Helen's a philosopher, at least Brett and I are lawyers. And so we tend to think about things more from a like, well, how are we gonna figure this out? So there are a couple of questions that this kind of leaves in my mind left open. One is, well, what if these background previous contextual norms were unfair or biased? They were created during a time when certain people had no power, and you know, so there are lots of potential problems with existing contextual norms. But also we might have a problem that we just don't all agree on what the right values are, or how to apply the values to a particular situation, and so forth. So there might
be. Catherine, can I ask you about this? Yeah, is the same the case with general moral principles? Because I don't even know what that means. I mean, I'm a philosopher, and there's lots of general moral principles I wouldn't agree with. I'm not a Kantian, right? So it seems odd to say, oh, we fall back on, you know, outdated general moral principles. I mean, that I hear that, and I hear Kant, right? Or I hear, you know, particularly when we're talking about new social or technological situations. So like what we're looking at is very squarely in that territory. And I don't think general moral principles give us much. So does your proposal also apply to when general moral principles don't go far enough or aren't specific enough or aren't agreed?
Well, so what we do is, so because of exactly these questions, because we had these questions and because we study governance, our approach is to look at this, take up the general framework that from Nissenbaum and the general idea of contextual norms, and that you have to have these very specific transmission, or that you should think of things in terms of very specific transmission principles and so on, but to really ask how exactly that question, like how do we deal with all of these things that are just not so clear for all of these reasons. And so our contribution to this is to say, well, let's look at privacy as a form of knowledge commons governance, which is something that we at least have been studying. So we know something about. Now, I will say, just kind of to warn you from the beginning, that our approach is primarily descriptive. So we are primarily doing empirical case studies of how do these things actually work, rather than normative. So we kind of are leaving the normative part to the society, the people involved, and so on. Now, we're moving a little bit away from that. We've been very reluctant to go much beyond that because we're doing case studies, and it takes a lot of case studies to be able to say much. We are currently thinking about, we have a series of books, and we're thinking about having one of our books be called something like Bad Commons or something like that, where we will look at or think about addressing what happens if commons are not socially, you know, are socially undesirable in various ways. But for what we have mostly been doing, we're mostly looking at whether it seems like the commons governance is working for the people that are involved. Nonetheless, I think that our framework is useful, and we have been told that it is useful for people that are trying to evaluate or think about or design their own frameworks as well, just because it gives you some questions to think about and some thoughts about things that have been turned out to be important in other examples. So that's what I'm going to turn to next, is this idea of rather than trying to rely so much on either pre-existing norms, which could be problematic or not apply or whatever, and general moral principles, which we might not all agree on, what if we think about this in terms of knowledge commons governance? So in order to talk about, you know, our work on that, I want to talk about our framework, which we call the governing knowledge commons framework, which is mostly, as I just mentioned, an empirical framework, but it does help to kind of raise issues or interesting questions, I think. It was very much inspired by Eleanor Ostrom's institutional analysis and development framework, or IAD framework, that she and her collaborators developed for studying natural resource governance. And we developed our framework originally. Mike and Brett and I, we were all IP scholars. And so we were all studying this question of, you know, why, you know, how's there so much creativity that happens without any IP or almost in spite of IP and so forth. We were all interested in those questions. And so we kind of developed this coming from that angle as a tool for analyzing institutions that were governing knowledge creation without relying primarily on IP. Although the framework could be used if IP is involved also. But that's why we developed it. We saw that there were a number of people doing very fascinating kind of one-off studies of different like informal norms-based approaches and so on. And we thought it was crying out for some systematization. So we use the term commons as in a very broad way to describe institutionalized sharing of resources among members of a community. And so that's the there are various meanings of commons. We're using this meaning. We are not using it as it is sometimes used to describe what some people would call the public domain, which is, you know, something that is shared with everyone under equal terms and so on. We're using it in more of the Ostrom kind of way. We're also using the term knowledge very broad way to refer to intellectual and cultural resources, information, science, knowledge, creative works, data, and so on. So we think all of these things can be discussed using this framework. And then knowledge commons is just a sharing of knowledge that is sustained by commons governance. So that's what we mean by knowledge commons. Why did we develop a different framework and why didn't we just use the Ostrom IAD framework? The reason was that we realized and argue that knowledge is different. So the IAD framework was developed with thinking about natural common pool resources, you know, like lakes or forests or fisheries. And these resources are somewhat rivalrous. They have characteristics that are set by nature to a large extent. Communities are often defined by geography. So it's the people that live around the lake that share the lake and so on. And governance questions are quite focused on sustainability and use. And what that leads to is a focus on overcoming particular kinds of social dilemmas, in particular, the tragedy of the commons or free rider problems. And we were coming from IP scholarship that was actually very similarly focused on free rider problems and tragedy of the commons. But we thought that in fact, knowledge is different. And so we should study it somewhat differently. Knowledge is non-rivalrous, at least in principle. It's human made. So it's not just there with set characteristics. In fact, the characteristics of the knowledge are often determined by the community and the way that the commons is governance and so forth. And in fact, not only that, but in many of the knowledge commons arrangements that we have looked at, it's not as though you have the people who live around the lake. You often have the community co-produce at the same time as the knowledge, and people can come in or come out and they're attracted or they're not. And so that's a very different thing than the way that the knowledge, the IAD framework kind of looked at things. Also the governance issues therefore focus on, in addition to sustainability and use, other questions like production and sharing. And we would now add things like privacy, because the information can be about people, which really we hadn't been thinking about when we first put this framework together. Now, that said, one thing that I would say after doing all these case studies that we've done and that we've collected from others is that there is a bit of a, it's not really a hard and fast bright line between a knowledge commons and a natural resource commons or something like that. Because in fact, many, maybe probably it's most commons involve the pooling and sharing of both knowledge and other kinds of resources. And so we do need a framework that recognizes both, which ours does. And in fact, one of the things that we have seen in the case studies that we've done is that it can often be the non-knowledge resources that provide the biggest stumbling blocks or barriers to getting the commons to actually work well. I'll talk a little bit more about that, and I can definitely explain more about what I mean by that. So I've got two, I'm gonna present our framework in two ways, neither of which is all that great for a slide, but let me do these two ways, and then I can certainly answer questions. So one way is this kind of graphical way. So Ostrom describes her IAD framework using the diagram that's on the top there, which I hope you can all see, in which you think about what's going on in a commons and analyze it in terms of inputs into what she called action arenas that produce patterns of interactions and outcomes. Then you evaluate that and then it goes back around. Okay, so in terms of the inputs, what are the inputs that were considered in her work? They are the biophysical characteristics of the resource that was being shared in a common pool way, attributes of the community, and then whatever the rules in use are that determine how people interact in the action arena. So an action arena is a kind of quite squishy and general concept that has to be sort of applied and kind of discovered in each particular case. But it's kind of any recurring situation that people are interacting in that involves the resources of interest. And that is governed by some kinds of rules in use, which is the term for how things really play out on the ground. So rules in use could be based on informal norms, could be based on some kinds of private agreements, could be based on law, could be based on all kinds of things. And in fact, there can be law on the books, and rules in use may or may not really reflect the law on the books, as we all know situations like that. And within an action arena, you have particular situations that come up, you have particular actors in particular roles. And this is how sort of things work. And the study is to try to kind of pick apart these things and figure out what's going on. So our framework is very similar, but we just have revised the diagram a bit in order to reflect the sort of characteristics of knowledge that are different. So we can't really talk about biophysical characteristics because the knowledge resources, in fact, are created, or often at least are created by in the action arenas of the community. Also, we do still talk about attributes of the community and rules in use, action situations and actors. So all that is sort of similar. But here, the outcomes are not just, you know, is it sustainable, or how is it being used, but things like the resources themselves and the attributes of the community. Those, in fact, are outcomes of what goes on in the action arenas. And so that requires a sort of, you know, different way of looking at it. So just to give like a quick little example of what this means, this is like an example that I like to give. I think about what we would call soccer and what everyone else would call football. Imagine a children's soccer league is kind of an example, right? So you could have an action arena is the games that are played by the teams in the league, right? And what resources go into making this work? Well, you know, there's the fields, there's the players, there's the coaches. Question of whether the players are really a resource or an actor, and we'll get back to that when we talk about patients in the research arena. But there's other kinds of resources too, like what are the rules? What are the kind of norms? Like you could imagine that there probably are some leagues where it's very competitive, and so it's okay for the parents to get really competitive and like yell at the coaches and stuff. And there are other leagues where the goals and values are different, and the idea is to make it enjoyable for everyone. And it would be really a violation of the rules in use for parents to start screaming at coaches. So And of course, you know, there, this is all embedded in a background environment of, you know, football writ large, but clearly some of the rules transfer down into this children's league context and some don't, right? So that's sort of the idea of how, I don't know if that's helpful or not, but that's sort of the idea of how to think about, like, what is an action arena? I mean, another action arena might be the meetings of the coaches at which they decide what the rules are going to be for their particular league. That would be a different kind of action arena in the same comments. Okay, so we took that sort of picture and we broke it down into a list of research questions. And I'm definitely not going to go through all these questions. But the idea being, I mean, we are thinking about doing case studies here. So for us, these are questions that kind of shape our interviews and any surveys we're going to do and how we're going to analyze documents and all that kind of thing. But they also are useful in kind of bringing up things that are going on that you might not necessarily have thought about. At least I've found it that way in the case studies I've done. So the first thing we have is let's talk about what's in the background environment. So what is the context of this particular commons? What are its normative values? You know, depending on the thing, you might want to ask whether these things are ordinarily copyrighted, open, or whatever. How does this community fit into a larger context? So there's a idea of sort of nested commons. Lots of things get brought in from the background context environment. So in my football example, like the general rules of soccer come in from the background environment, and so forth. And maybe like general ideas about what children's sports leagues should be like. Okay, and then what are the attributes of this commons? What are the resources that are pooled? And that should include thinking about not just the knowledge resources, but kind of all of the resources. And I mentioned before that, you know, we've seen that while some knowledge commons are mostly about pooling knowledge, in many cases, there are other resources that are important, like funding or like computer resources to store the data, databases to store the data. People's time turns out to be a hugely important one in many of these. So what are these resources? Is there a shared infrastructure? We've seen the importance of infrastructure in many of our case studies. And then when we're talking about privacy, we want to ask in a given action arena, what role is personal information playing here? Like, how does it get into here? You know, what is its role? What are the attributes? Who are the community members, et cetera? So I wasn't gonna go through them all, so I won't. And then of course, another question that is very important in the knowledge commons area, not so, you know, much brought to the front in the IAD framework, is what are the goals and objectives of this commons? What is trying to be accomplished? Who's deciding what those goals are and what are the values? And are there perhaps, you know, conflicts and so on over those goals and objectives? So there's a more detailed version of this in basically any of our books or papers. So I won't go through it in any greater detail than that, but just to say that this is the way the case studies that I'm gonna tell you about were structured. And then we ask about the governance. What are the action arenas? What kinds of social dilemmas are people facing in this particular commons? You know, it's not always just free riders and tragedy of the commons. Could be lots of other kinds of social dilemmas. What kinds of governance mechanisms are being used? How does the technology structuring decision-making, which is often really important in the privacy area, informal norms and questions about legitimacy. Are these institutions perceived as legitimate and by whom? And is everybody who's affected involved in the governance? And if not, why not? So on. Okay, so then we ask about the patterns and outcomes, the benefits, the costs that are associated with this commons. That's kind of the overview of how we structure the studies. And again, I could talk a lot more specifically, or you can look at any of the books to see like much more detailed lists of all these questions. So I started out talking about contextual integrity, and now I'm talking about GKC. So I just wanted to say how these kind of correspond. And it's funny because I was working on these two things like completely separately. They were like in different boxes in my head. And then all of a sudden it was like, oh, hey, these are almost the same. Because of course, in contextual integrity, you have context. In GKC, you have the background environment. In contextual integrity, you have personal information. In GKC, you have resources, of which personal information is one. You have actors and roles. You have rules in use, and you have transmission principles. And we think about legitimacy, and there's questions of appropriateness. And the main thing that we add by adding the GKC approach is these questions of governance. How are we going to make these decisions about appropriateness? How are they being made? And then, of course, how should they be made? So that's kind of the background. And I'll just tell you a few of the things that we kind of that we observed in most of this is coming out of the conclusion chapter of the Privacy Commons book. Kind of what did we observe in these case studies that we pulled together? So one thing that we observed was that there were three kind of basic governance patterns that we that were in the case studies. So one set was what we call voice-shaped commons, where the members of the commons have a lot of input into the governance. And when it comes to privacy, it's interesting to be careful to look at the question of whether the information subjects are members, participating members who do have a voice in the commons governance or not. And in some of the cases they were, and in some they weren't. And also I'll say that these are case studies from the book, which I can talk about if you want, but we also, you'll see more of them showing up sometimes in more than one box and even in more than one governance pattern, because sometimes some aspects are governed one way and some aspects are governed another way. Also, we noticed that it was important to distinguish between situations in which the personal information itself was a resource that the commons was intending to cultivate and use and share, or whether the personal information was just kind of a collateral flow. Like, you know, you go to a meeting with Chatham House rules and the information of who you are and who what you said is partly is collateral flow. It's not really what was what we're trying to create in this commons, but it nonetheless exists. And sometimes this collateral flow, personal information, is really important to the problems with privacy that arise. Then there were some commons that are more like, we call them exit-shaped commons, where, and this is a lot of kind of platform-based based commons, that there were a lot of studies of those in our book, where the participants can't shape the governance, they can't really make the rules very well, but they can leave. It's pretty easy for them to leave if they don't like what's going on. Again, here, it might be that the information subjects are in fact these participants who can leave, or they're not. They're somebody else who is being discussed rather than someone who's participating. And then finally, there are imposed commons where participants cannot, at least, oops, sorry, just dropped my ear, my headphone, can't shape the governance and effectively can't exit. Not that it's impossible, but that it's really hard to exit. And in those cases, we noticed that there were some where the where it was shaped by the government. The government put certain, and none of these are like kind of with a moral, with a normative value. These are just observations. Some things are shaped, for example, by the government. When the government is funding your rare disease consortium, you could exit only to the extent of just like not having one, right? But it's hard, very hard to exit. And sometimes they're shaped by private actors that can range from anything from Facebook that is providing underlying structure for the activist groups that, in fact, that was one of the studies that I did. Something like Galaxy Zoo, where the private actors are creating the rules. And sometimes for some people, it's easy to exit. For other people, it's not. So these are just kind of patterns that emerged. And of course we found, or not of course, but I will tell you that we found that many case studies blended all three forms of governance. And very importantly, it might be that different groups experience different governance patterns. So for example, the patients in the Patient Innovation Project and in the RDCRN, which is the Rare Disease Research Coordination Network, the participants in Facebook activist groups, all of these people had a voice in only some aspects of the way that, in this case, privacy governments, the flows of personal information, were governed. The researchers in some of these, the researchers in the RDCRN and the leaders in the Facebook activist groups had more power to shape the privacy government, but still some aspects were just imposed either by government or by the platform. Okay, so those were sort of overall patterns. And then I'll finish by talking about some recurring themes that we have seen in the Privacy Commons case studies and also in a lot of our other studies of knowledge commons. So perhaps this isn't, none of these are necessarily a huge surprise, but here's what we've observed. The success of the commons arrangements often depends on trust. And that can mean trust among participants or trust in the leadership, that is, particularly when the leadership is setting a lot of the rules. And that is true even when you're not necessarily trying to collect personal information, but it's just flowing as a collateral effect of activities in the commons. Commons governance, I already hinted at this, can be successful for members, but illegitimate from the perspective of affected outsiders. This was kind of a huge issue in the rare disease research area that I did some case studies about, so I know a little bit about that. However, there were governance changes that were made that seemed to be quite successful in giving more legitimacy by involving the patients more in the activities of the commons and in some of the decision making. The fact that resources and communities co-emerge seems to be especially significant where the commons govern personal information, because if personal information is not treated appropriately, then certain people will not join the community, will not be part of the community, or when it's impossible to treat information appropriately. I'll give one example. In our study of immigrant rights activism on Facebook, we found that many people who were undocumented were not going to be joining a Facebook group for immigrant rights activism. And so they couldn't be part of that aspect of it. So often what would happen is one of their relatives would be the, you know, the person who actually joined, who was documented. So personal information can strongly affect the extent to which the resources actually get created in the first place. It isn't all about free rider problems. Knowledge commons tend to confront a lot of different kinds of social dilemmas. Dilemmas due to interactions between researchers and patients are something we saw. Interestingly to me, transaction costs are often like the most crucial dilemmas and barriers for people. And probably because of that, shared infrastructure is often just critically important to making the commons work. And we saw that the shared infrastructure, at least in the case studies we've done so far, was rarely produced communally. So usually the shared infrastructure was provided by the government, provided by a platform, or in a surprising number of really interesting cases, there was an individual who became like a commons entrepreneur, like, I'm going to make this infrastructure. And this is really important because, of course, infrastructure creates rules in use for the governance of use of all kinds of resources and in particular personal information. It's also just really important to realize that the participants in these arrangements can have very diverse motivations and incentives and so on, and to kind of try to take them all into account. Okay, so I was gonna talk a little bit about this one case study, but I didn't think I would have time and I don't, so I'll stop.
That's great, thanks so much. There's lots to think about. I mean, it might be that this is a good case study for us, given our interests. I'm conflicted. Why don't we start with some questions and we'll see how it goes. And then I might get you to talk about this because it does relate quite closely, I think.
Yeah.
Questions? Sorry, I'm not able to see everybody at once. So anybody want to start? So I wonder if it is useful perhaps to talk briefly about this case study, because it does kind of parallel some of what we are interested in stem cells, because of, you know, sort of the combination of information around kind of the information produced, but then sort of groups or, you know, laboratories or whatever else that are together, and then the conflicts between commercial and confidence and publicly available, et cetera, et cetera.
Sure.
I'm
happy to talk about that, because these actually is, I did, it's been a while since I did these case studies, but we studied three different consortia in this network. So I've done a few different case studies. So there's some things that were different, but there's some commonalities. And so I'm happy to talk about it. So the Rare Disease Clinical Research Network, in case you don't know, is a network of consortia that are funded by the NIH. It was established in 2003. And I just checked the website right now, that seems that there are 20 consortia. Each is dealing with a different kind of cluster of rare diseases. The funding is not for the research. The funding is basically for establishing the consortium. One thing that the funding does cover, I believe, is what they call the longitudinal study, which is a longitudinal study of various, you know, they have the patients come in and they measure various things depending on the disease, and they, you know, they look at various things. So they're trying to get a kind of long-term look at symptoms and you know, physical characteristics and so forth. So, so I think that is funded, but because that's required for every yeah. consortium. Okay. So there's a network level that involves like all the consortia together, but I'm going to start here at the consortium level just to show how this is organized. There are PIs from all of these different clinical centers. And that, of course, is one of the main challenges of rare disease research, is that you have to, and this is clinical research, so you have to have all these different clinical centers. There is an overall study coordinator. The consortium has a steering committee that basically is like the leadership of the consortium. And also, at least in the ones we studied, the patient advocacy group, I believe, is required. You're required to have a patient advocacy group as part of your membership of your consortium. And one thing I would say from the, you know, vast number of three that we studied was that it seemed as though the consortia that were able to really integrate the patient advocacy groups and the patients most effectively seemed to be very successful, and also kind of making everybody happier, as far as we could tell. Yeah. So you have all these different clinical research sites, and then also you have an NIH, two NIH officers that are kind of part of the particular consortium, a science officer and a project officer. There is outside of the consortium, but very important, a data management coordinating center, which is one of those infrastructure things I was talking about that provides, you know, common standards for databases and all that kind of stuff for each consortium, but also for the network as a whole. And then at every clinical research site, you have a site PI, some other researchers, site coordinator. The study coordinator is also kind of involved with all of the sites, of course, patients and their families, and sometimes some pharmaceutical companies that were involved in potentially developing therapies. So that was the structure. And some of the observations, I'm sorry, my slides are so like, I'm terrible at making some of the observations that we made, which were, you know, this was one of the first studies we did. So these were kind of, some of these were a little surprising to us at the time. Also, we knew nothing about this area of rare disease research before we started. One of the things is that we were thinking about a knowledge commons, but I've also already mentioned, there are lots of resources that were involved in these. And it was really important that we didn't only focus on the knowledge, that we looked at funding and how is it being shared and who's getting it and how that's being governed. The patients themselves are both participants and resources because you need them for research subjects. There was the coordinated, the data bank. There was all kinds of, you know, all the research of knowledge about the disease, of knowledge about research practice, publications, very important. I will say that coming in there as an IP person, I was like, where's your IP policy? And what do everybody think about that? Nobody cared, the researchers that we interviewed, at all about that. They're like, the university will deal with that. Everybody cared about the publication policy. Like, who gets to be author, who can use which data? And they all had these, that was almost the only thing that was like formal and written that everybody knew about. But of course there are also, you know, research and treatment, people know about those too, but it was just the publication thing was very important to people. And of course in this commons, as in many of the privacy and personal information is just one part of this very complicated picture. And also there are many, many kinds of actors involved, not just the kind of PIs, like the researchers that would be on the grant, but all of the study coordinators who were incredibly important, the site coordinators, the patients, the patient advocacy group, the, you know, et cetera. And there were lots of different action situations to look at. It turned out that this longitudinal study, which was required by NIH, was one of the most important action arenas. And I think one of the most important pieces of infrastructure for the success of these commons, because it was something that engaged everybody. It was something that gave everybody a possibility of having publications. It was something that was kind of a joint project rather than like, everybody also had all their own, you know, one-off projects as well. So that seemed to be really important. And then of course, there's all kinds of other action situations. So just a few other observations about it. Because of the fact that with a rare disease, you have to recruit a very large fraction of all the patients, the longitudinal study is very important, but it also takes a lot of time and effort from the patients because they have to come in and, you know, report all this stuff and get these tests and everything. And none of that is immediately affecting, you know, giving them relief or treating them. So there's a huge potential. This is one of the cases where there actually is a huge potential for free riding. So you got to motivate the patients to participate. And what seemed to be very important for that was the patient advocacy groups. And also just really important about the trust in those particular clinician researchers who were involved. And some of the things that seem to be helping to facilitate that trust was that the consortium would have an annual meeting with their patient advocacy group, and they would have researchers there giving presentations and lectures to the people who came, who most of these diseases very sadly are pediatric diseases, so it's mostly the parents who came to these meetings. And these people are mostly, you know, pretty knowledgeable because this is like a huge part of their lives, and were there to answer questions and to explain what they were doing. Rules governing use of patient registries, which I think maybe kind of standard, but seemed important that the patients were informed, here's a study you might want to join, but they never gave out the patient info to the researchers and let them go about contacting them about a study. The consortium structure was designed to encourage patient input, and in the most successful ones, they really successfully incorporated patient input in ways that that actually affected research priorities. And both we didn't talk to a lot of individual patients, but we talked to patient advocacy group leaders, Both those people and the researchers talked about how important it was to have that input into their research priorities, and had specific examples of where things that the researchers themselves might not have prioritized were prioritized. This, I think, was a little bit, I don't know what ended up happening about this because it was kind of under discussion. But the patients wanted to have some control over the data if it was going to be used by commercial pharma companies. Now, they wanted that to happen because they wanted there to be treatments, obviously. And they also wanted to maybe be able to get control back if, the company tried to develop something and failed. And so that was a whole area that we didn't study too much, but that I think was very important. Of course, you have to involve all these clinical sites. And so there's a lot of potential issues there. Researchers can be competitive with each other. They can just, want a free ride also. So what made that work? I cannot tell you the number of times when someone told me that patient care was the primary driver for these people because they were pediatricians. Like, we're pediatricians and we care about our patients. But of course, also the people participating in the consortium self-select. They're all people who told me they like to collaborate, or not all, but many of them said they like to collaborate, they like to share knowledge. And having the structure helped to overcome some of these issues, and also helped to get patient recruitment, which would make it possible for it to be successful. But it's a complex governance issue where trust was very important, where these inclusiveness efforts with the patients, but also I noticed at the annual meeting, for example, that they had all the site coordinators came to the annual meeting. They had their own meeting and they were introduced to all the researchers rather than just kind of like left off in a corner. They had monthly teleconferences that were required by the NIH. Those included a patient advocacy group representative and a representative of the site coordinators. So just this inclusion of everyone. I've already mentioned about the publication policy.
I think that's really interesting, because I think for some of our case studies, this is going to be directly relevant, where it is indeed something that falls in this rare disease or fairly small, in part also because it's Australia. Diane.
Yeah, that was really great, Katherine. Just such an amazing body of work, really excellent. But, I was just sort of thinking, so you've got all of the descriptive components on how they do things. And I just wondered what happened if you went to the next step of the evaluation, for particular types of things, what worked and what didn't, and whether any sort of best practices emerged so that you could say, if you've got this type of commons, you should make sure that you have this and this and this and so on.
Yeah, it's a great question. And it's something that we are thinking about. We resisted doing this for a very long time because we just are doing case studies and we don't want to get like out ahead of. But I will say the evaluation part was in there, at least in many of the studies, not from an outside perspective, but more from asking the people involved whether they were satisfied. So that's why, it's more of a, are you achieving your goals and objectives kind of evaluation. That we did ask about in many of the case studies. And, that does allow us to say things like the importance of the trust and how that seemed to help things work and some of these things. So we're kind of inching our way towards best practices. I mean, one of the things that I personally think is two things that I personally just think are very important takeaways from all of, not just the privacy, but all the case studies. One, this infrastructure thing is just hugely important. And I think somebody's got to provide this infrastructure, and I don't know, but it doesn't seem like we very often see it kind of like being provided collectively. Maybe that's just the cases we studied, but so that's one. And the other thing is this idea that it's not all about free rider problems. Sometimes people really want to cooperate. They really want to share things. But I'll tell you an example. The NIH requires these monthly conferences from the rare disease. So, people go to them. So I asked some of the people we interviewed. So why do you need the NIH for this? Why don't you just like have a monthly conference, right? Couldn't you just do that? And of course the answer is yes, you could, but there's a barrier because everybody's incredibly busy. So having it as a requirement of the grant, like made it happen, you know, in a way that's kind of, you know, maybe you wouldn't necessarily think of that, but so that kind of thing, that's just like other resources of time and transaction costs and things like that. Not that there aren't free rider problems, but you know, it's not only about that. It's not only about those kind of problems.
Okay, Edie, and then Chris, I think you sort of answered Joan's question that's in the comments, which is, you know, how do these norms come to be settled and so on. Edie first, and then Chris. I am conscious we're already over time. A few of us have to be somewhere else, but go ahead, Edie.
Okay, the questions are more in terms of the communities and the affected outsiders when you're thinking about the action arenas. Because if you have different levels, some affected outsiders will be part of the next level of the actors of the action arena. Does that make sense?
Yes, so yeah, sure. So, I mean, for example, the people setting the rules, the leaders, this is true like in many, many commons that we studied, but the leaders are setting a lot of the rules. And obviously this is affecting the participants because they are following those rules. But then there's also like a further boundary of like, so one action arena is rule setting. Of course, those rule setting affect, that's just an example, but yes, I agree.
Yeah, so just following up on that. So when you're studying the commons, do you define like these diverse action arenas, or you study one and then you define like these are the actors in this action arena and these are the affected outsiders? We are not gonna include them as part of the community, you know, just.
Yeah, so in some ways, this is just a kind of research design question. So I can tell you what I've done in the studies that I've done, but I don't think everybody does it necessarily the same way. So what we did was we gathered up our data and we asked all those questions like in the, you know, interviewed as many people as we could. We tried to do some surveys, which were less successful, and reviewed all these documents stuff. Then we looked at all of this data and we tried to kind of categorize it. And we let the action arenas, like what are the important action arenas, kind of emerge from that. And for example, I would never have thought of the longitude, maybe anybody who knows something about this would have, but I would not have thought of the longitudinal study as being such an important action arena. But that clearly emerged from our study. And then you can't study all action arenas. So we kind of picked the ones that we thought were most important and that had the most, you know, we had enough data to really say something about it. So there's always limitations on that. You know, like I said, we talked to patient advocacy group. We didn't talk really to a lot of individual patients. We got IRB approval to do it. And then we just kind of didn't find people. It didn't work out.
Interesting. You're going to really worry Edie here because she's about to start doing this stuff, but we might continue to have a conversation. Chris, last question.
Katherine, I just wanted to say thank you for a really thought-provoking talk. And I really like the way you've framed out a very complex area. My question really comes down to scalability. And one of the challenges we have here in Australia is we're actually quite a small community. And if I give an example of some of the rare diseases or clinical trial networks that you've used in your case studies, you know, frequently it's hard to recruit into those clinical trials because patients with rare diseases are already in a clinical trial that's competing for their participation, if you like. So my question is really, you know, what's the point at which, in terms of scale, where these commons frameworks become incredibly valuable to map a very complex landscape, and what's the point where, you know, the community really is too small to be able to self-organize or be organized in this way?
So I don't know if I have a good answer to that, but I can tell you a few anecdotal comments. One is that most of the consortia that we studied, well, we studied three, and I also started another rare disease research community that wasn't an our DCRN. It seemed as though most of them were able to get most of the people who were really seriously working in that area on that disease into the consortium. There were few, surprisingly to us, we thought there'd be more like disgruntled people and so on. And maybe we just didn't find them. It's quite possible, you know, we just missed them. But we only ran across one example where someone was sort of, you know, like asked to leave the consortium because they weren't contributing patients. And so that was kind of the metric. And one thing I will say that they did was within the consortium, the data about how many patients were participating in the longitudinal study, which again was the main way of like bringing everyone in, the data about how many patients were participating from a particular site was in monthly reports that everybody could see. And so I'm sure that was incentive for people to try to get their patient, you know, their patients to participate. So in most of the cases, they were, and these were mostly, I don't know, they had like 10, 12 sites, something like that. So they weren't like huge numbers of sites. There was in the other disease that I studied where we weren't looking at an RDCRM, but just kind of at a research community. There were like kind of more in the way of competing groups that were kind of trying to do research and that weren't so much cooperating with each other. And that had partly to do, I think, with scientific disagreements, but I don't really know for sure. So
Chris, I suspect with us, it's going to be a bit of a hypothesis, right? Because unlike the US, you know, we really only have a couple cities where there's any players. And if the patients live near those cities, presumably they're going to be in competition for the same patients. I don't know. I mean, it's kind of an empirical question on how many people.
Yeah, we didn't have, that is a good point because there were very few examples. I'm trying to remember, and I might not remember this too well, this detail, but I'm sure it's in our write-up. I don't think there were very many cities where there was more than one site that was part of the consortium. Yeah. Mm. I think there were a few, but mostly there was like one site in the city. But within
a site. So I think we'll pull that one because that's published, right? Because it seems like that's really directly relevant to our stuff. And we'll look at it and read it maybe in our journal club.
Yeah.
And then get back to you with questions.
Those are in, I think they're in our books. And books, like I said, are all open access. So there's one in our first book, and then there are two of them in the Medical Commons book.
Yeah, that's what I thought. Yeah, that's where I think I've seen it, but I haven't looked at it quite in the same way now that it's really central to our project. This is fabulous. Thank you so much. I think we have a lot to think about.